no one on either side is prepared to have a real conversation about race. And here's the thing. You cannot have that race.
White people want to have a real conversation.
Hold on. You cannot have that discussion divorced from history. It is impossible.
No, it's not. What? I've been on Earth 72 years now, and over the last 60 years or so, Black people have gotten worse. They're followers and not leaders. They're beggars and takers and not workers and givers. And so I see them in action, and I also see how they're being pulled by the so-called upper Blacks and the government and stuff. But anyway, I want to ask you, what has this Nile Valley movement and all the stuff you mentioned about Egypt done for you personally?
Oh, that's a very good question. I wasn't even sure that you would ask me something like that. Well, the first thing that it did was it afforded me something that you place great value on. It afforded me a different view of, it afforded me a different worldview so that my mind would not be incarcerated in the mess that you speak to. And I'm not negating that mess exists. But that's what ancient Egypt did for me, the study of it. It availed me to a wider body of knowledge. It put a lot of things on planet Earth in a historical context for me so that I could locate myself in present time and understand my relationship to everything and everything else's relationship to me as an individual and to us as a group. I will tell you one thing that I think you would find interesting, Jesse, and I couldn't wait to talk to you about this. I said, this is going to blow his mind, probably. I said, not even know blow his mind. I just want to see what his reaction is going to be. So the thing that fascinates me the most about Black America and white America is what I call the forbidden conversation, right? So people like to pretend that there's a conversation or a discourse going on between Black America and white America. There is no real conversation going on between Black America and white America, because in order for that to happen, both sides are going to have to be very honest. And the one thing that I've discovered studying history for the 30 years that I've been studying it is that all cultures, not just some cultures or one culture, but all cultures have a very peculiar way of dealing with historical shame. All cultures, Africa, European, and Asian, they all, and others, Hispanic, doesn't matter. All cultures have a very peculiar way of dealing with shame. And it's that peculiar way of dealing with shame on a cultural and a historical level and on a racial level that keeps us from having a very honest discourse and conversation. So what makes me sad is that the real conversation will probably not be had in your lifetime, Jesse. And I'll tell you why.
Why?
The very simple reason. Because people would have to admit certain things that they don't want to admit. And I'll give you an example. I teach a course called, you can go to my website, shakamos.com. I teach a course called Black Masters, White Slaves. Now, when you hear that title, Black Masters, White Slaves, what comes to mind to you?
That it's unfortunate that the white people are allowing these Blacks to enslave them in their own country.
Okay,
America,
well, what would you
was
say?
Founded and built by white people, right, and now the radical Blacks are enslaving them in their own country.
Okay, so the problem with that assessment that America was built by white people. If America was built by white people, there would have been no need to go get slaves. So we're going to just dismiss that.
Well, they need some workers, man.
But you say building. Building requires physical activity. So if you're going to say who built what, you have to include those people who made the contribution to
It wasn't like Black people came to America and volunteered to do it.
Whether they volunteered or not, they did it.
The white people said
they volunteered or not, they did it.
The white people said to the Blacks, okay, I need a worker. You looking for a job? Yeah. And the Blacks said, yes, sir. And so they went, and they said, okay, the way I'll pay you is that you can live on my land. I will feed you. I will house you. And once in a while, I'll throw in a few bucks and you can buy some.
Oh, you're talking about sharecropping. Okay.
Buy some.
That's not slavery. That's sharecropping.
Some wine.
So I understand that.
And so, right. But let me ask you this.
Jesse, before you go on, I want to share something with you very briefly. I just want to really put this out there. I'm not one of these young spring chickens, right? So I spent my childhood in the South like you spent your childhood.
How
in the
old
South.
Are you?
I try not to divulge that. I'm older than I look.
You don't tell your age?
Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Depending on the mood I'm in. I'll share this with you. When I was born, Lyndon B. Johnson was president. Okay, so there you go.
So you're like 80.
Okay, and there you go. I'm about 85. Okay, so that's my point. So that's why I really enjoy speaking with you because in many respects, I relate to you. And one of the things that a lot of people would probably be disconcerted about when it comes to me, because they see me as Mr. Super Pro Black, Mr. You know, Africa.
Yeah.
In many contexts, I am. But the reality of it is that there are a number of positions that you hold that I actually agree with. So unfortunately, you and I will not be at odds about everything. But I think about some fundamental things, we will certainly definitively be at pure odds.
Amazing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let me ask, are there black people that look like you that lives in Egypt?
Today,
right now.
In Upper Egypt, yes. In Upper Egypt, yes.
But,
and probably all over Egypt. But, yeah,
but the most of the people that live there and run the country are non-looking black. They look more like Allahu Akbar people or...
You kill me when you say that. Allahu Akbar people. Hey, you got to stop for it. I got to share something with you. You do realize that Allah was not originally, but at some point in his evolution, Allah was the God of the Christians. You do realize that, right?
No, I don't.
Yeah, see, that's what I mean. See, people, when you...
I don't know where you get that from.
Well, here's the thing.
Allah hated the Christians.
Jesse, hold on one second. Just hold on one second, okay? You can't teach what you don't know. That's number one. Most people, not just African-Americans, most people are historically illiterate. You are historically illiterate. I know that because I listen to you when you speak.
Yeah, I'm black and slow.
But it has nothing to do with your color. That's why I said most people are historically
illiterate. If I was white, I wouldn't be slow, buddy.
That's not true. There are many, many slow white people.
I never met one.
I know them. Let me share something. I have a lot of white friends. My best friend happens to be white, all right? Which is a trope that people use. But my best friend is a white Harvard graduate from
Maine.
Don't
say that loud, right? Man. You're so into the African thing.
I've said it. I've
black
said it
people
many
are going to hang you. They ain't going to string you up talking about you got a white friend.
Let me share something with you. Black people who are integrated into themselves, they don't have any issue with white people. They have issues with injustice and they have issues with inequity. And they have issues with black people, you do. So that's why I don't think that you're, you know, look, a lot of what you do is it's marketing, it's attention getting, and I get it.
But
right?
I'm not thinking that way, though. I'm trying to wake up the people. I want black people to be free again.
But I believe that, but here's the thing, though. You can't, if you are going to cancel out your message by virtue of the way you're delivering it, then you may end up doing more injury than harm. And so you won't accomplish your goal. So I'll give you an example. Walking around wearing t-shirts saying White History Month, but then speaking in a denigrating way about Black History Month, that's going to kill your message. It's going to make you look hypocritical. Nobody wants to listen to a hypocrite. And one of the questions that your producer said I would be asked was, what was my history with Christianity? I grew up in a church. I was a Christian.
Yeah.
There was a period in my life where I did accept Jesus Christ.
But let me
tell
you, I want to get to that, but I'm looking at the clock and I want to get to that. I have so many questions for you. About the discussion that white and black people want to have. White people want to have a discussion with blacks about slavery, about this phony idea of racism and everything, but black people are so hooked on this idea of racism that once you try to tell them the truth, they're going to use the word racism and the whole discussion is over because white people know that they're not responsible for the condition of blacks. Blacks are responsible for their own condition, and white people want to say that, but they know there's not a legitimate discussion a legitimate discussion will happen because blacks are so hateful toward white people. And they have been getting away with this word for racism forever now. And so white people don't even...
Jesse, I got to stop
white
you.
People who are alive
Jesse,
today
Jesse,
have nothing to do
Jesse,
with black...
Jesse, the one thing I'm not going to
let
do,
Let me just
Jesse.
Finish that. White
Go
people
ahead.
Who are alive today have nothing to do with the condition of the blacks.
Right.
And so blacks are unwilling to have a fair and real discussion.
Okay. So here's the problem. There is inequity in your conversation. You keep speaking about how hateful black people are towards white people.
Yes.
And the issue with that is that you are basically advancing an image that is, it belies the actual facts. And the actual facts is that the hatred is mutual. It's not one way. It's a mutual dislike and hatred. It certainly is.
No, it's not.
It absolutely
it's really
is.
Not.
It is. But here's the thing. It's unfair.
Really, really not.
It is. I know that it is because I live in America. I live in the same country you live in.
It's really, really not. It's an illusion to think that.
It certainly is. No, here it is. If you make a conscious choice not to see it, so here's the thing.
No,
right?
I can see what's going on, man.
No. Okay, Jesse, here's the thing. The hatred is mutual. It doesn't require for you to agree with it. It doesn't require for anyone on your staff to agree with it. The hatred is mutual. That is, and by depicting it as being one way, you are going to be part of the problem and not part of the solution. Rather than saying, hey, look, here's a list of reasons why, or here's a list of grievances from both sides. Here's a list of grievances from white people, why they strongly dislike black people. Here's a list of grievances from black people, why they strongly dislike white people.
But
and then you sit down, and you have an honest discussion about it. The point that I'm making to you and to your show and to your audience is that no one on either side is prepared to have a real conversation about race. And here's the thing. You cannot have that race.
White people want to have a real conversation.
Hold on. You cannot have that discussion divorced from history. It is impossible.
No, it's not. What the?
You cannot have that discussion divorced from history. And I'll tell you why. Because people are walking around with racial illusions and racial delusions in their mind. That includes you. That includes your staff.
No.
That includes people that follow me. One second. That includes people that follow me. That includes people that follow people like Farrakhan and everyone else. When you are historically illiterate, everybody in the room is a fucking idiot. And that's what it comes down to. It takes people who actually know history to put people on the same page. So that's when you need that. So that's when you need to start asking the right questions.
Let me ask you this.
Hold on, Jesse. You said a moment ago, you said that the people in Egypt today don't look black, right?
Right.
So let me ask you a question.
The ones that are ruling Egypt.
Right.
And yes, you do have some black looking folks live on there over there, but right. They ain't doing nothing.
Well, let me
just
ask you a question.
Looking at the Egyptians making the country great in the same way the blacks are doing over here, man.
But the blacks in Egypt are Egyptians. So when you say the Egyptians, you're saying the Egyptians are making the country look great.
The one don't look like y'all.
You mean the one that don't look like us?
Yeah,
what about
you guys.
The one that don't look like us?
What?
What about the ones that don't look like us?
They're the one making Egypt great. They're
okay,
the one
so
that,
I'm asking you. So I'm asking you a question. My question to you is, why is it that those people who are running the country in Egypt, why is it that they don't look like us?
Because they are the original Egyptian.
And that's where you're wrong. That's what I mean.
But let me tell you, I gotta move on.
Okay, one second. Before you move on, I don't want you to give your audience misinformation. You just said that they're the original one.
I've seen them before. I know Egyptians.
You got it backwards. They are not the original ones. They are descendants of those who are not the people who created the state of Egypt.
So they're lying too?
Yes, they are.
So the white people lying, the Egyptians lying, the Jews are lying. Everybody that's doing great are lying about the blacks.
But that's the way history works. History
so why blacks don't do better? If they're so smart and they believe they're the head of everything, why don't we see them doing better? They're destroying. They're not building anything.
Well,
uh-huh.
One second. Hold on one second. This is not an aha moment.
uh, 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 uh.
For First of all, you say that they're not building anything.
They're destroying. Okay. Look what they're doing to America. Look what they're doing to Egypt and everywhere.
Let me ask you a question. Blacks in Egypt are destroying Egypt?
Yeah, meaning that they ain't doing nothing over there. Just sit back looking at the Egyptians working hard and doing their thing. Why aren't blacks doing better if they're so smart?